Welcome. Good evening. How are you?
Very good.
Good. So take a deep breath. And for a moment, just relax your thinking mind. Just give away all thoughts. Give it back to life. Give it back to God. Disown every single thought. For just a moment. And notice the instant ease, the instant spaciousness, the instant freedom, the permission not to have to do anything about anything for just a moment. I can be in multiple places at the same time. Take another deep breath. And give away even more of your ideas, your beliefs, for just a few seconds, so that you can notice and acknowledge the empty space, the empty sky of your very own here and now. Awareness. And just enjoy the ease of it, the spaciousness. Notice how effortlessly you are hearing my voice. You don't have to do that. You don't have to listen. You just perceive. And again, enjoy the ease that that brings. So you're dropping into your greater self. You're dropping into the freedom that's always here. Nice. Today's topic is the adept focus. Become one with anything you desire. I'll just read this little paragraph here. In this session, Bentinho will take us into the ability to attain deep states of union consciousness with any object or state of our choice. When you grasp the adept's focus, you will quickly become proficient at anything you choose to commit to and anything you wish to realize, whether it be spiritual or material in nature. Who is the adept? This term, I decided upon this term while I was creating some of the academy courses. I have this online academy. It shares all my teaching step by step. And while I was writing some of these lessons, every once in a while it was appropriate to address the student. But the word student didn't feel right to me. The word practitioner is okay. But I wanted something honorable, something worthy of your commitment. Because if you are going through that step-by-step process that shows your commitment to your self-realization. So I remember from a series of books I read in the past that they used the word adept to refer to the, shall I say, sincere spiritual seeker or the dedicated practitioner, one that's devoted to their own alignment, to their own progression, to their own evolution. And it also has, originally, it comes from the idea of the alchemist. So it has some connotation of transformation, transmutation of baser metals into gold. So I landed on that word. So the adept is one who is sincerely devoted to their own evolution, to their own expansion of consciousness, to their own alignment, to their own balance, to their own state of clarity as to who they are and why they are here and what they desire and what is most important, and then they have the commitment to dedicate themselves to that. So, who is the adept? I'm assuming all of you, myself included. And today I wish to share with you what I call the adept's focus, which is going to help you with all the things that I shared in the past 2 or 3 months with you guys in these live streams, in these weekly meetings. when it comes to being a really powerful co-creator, being a really powerful manifester and chooser of who you are, of your state of being. So one of the things that you need, or that is really helpful for that, is to have at least to some extent the ability to really understand what focus is, what it means to deliberately direct consciousness onto something of your choosing, of your choice. And when you grasp this concept a little better, it becomes easier to actually put it to practice. And when you start putting it to practice, you'll start seeing results real quickly, real quick, regardless of what your end goal is, regardless of what your desire is, because that's up to you, whatever makes you tick. But this is one of the means that can help you in making your creation, your choosing, your clarity, your evolution into greater consciousness more precise, more concise, less distracted, in a sense. So I come from a background where initially my spiritual seeking, one of the initial works that really inspired me to become a devoted, sincere adept in that sense, were the Yoga Sutras of Patanjali. And one of the things, I don't usually refer to ancient spiritual scriptures or terms, but in this case it sort of applies. So yoga doesn't only consist of body movement, it actually consists of 8 steps, so to speak, and the last few steps are called dharana, dhyana and samadhi. Dharana stands for concentration, and I'll explain all of these through guided meditations in a little bit. So dharana stands for concentration. So when you bring your consciousness to a particular idea, to a particular object, or to a particular state of mind, or state of being, or quality of consciousness, or vibration, and then you get a little bit distracted from it, maybe negative thoughts spiral you out of that delicious focus, which is completely fine. But then concentration is the act of, through your desire, through having really clearly stated to yourself what is most important to you, through natural devotion, that consciousness, your attention, will return again and again inevitably at some point to the objects of your choice. Now, this does not have to be applied necessarily in a meditative setting where you choose to be aware of one object only. I'm talking in general terms too, when it comes to who you wish to be, or what you wish to manifest, or what you wish to realize within yourself. Any of these goals that we all have, you will find that if you are truly desirous of that state of being, of that state of clarity, then you will find yourself shifting your consciousness periodically back again and again and again to the object of your choice, right? Even if you get distracted for a bit, or quote-unquote life takes over seemingly, even though that's a choice as well, then we keep returning our attention, whether that's like days in between or just seconds in between, doesn't really matter, but we keep returning our attention to the focus of our desire. So that is concentration. It's where you, for moments at a time, are focused upon something of your choice. Then dhyana stands for meditation. And in the Yoga Sutras, this is described as the making concentration continuous. Or as soon as concentration falls into place, it becomes a continuous stream. And one of the analogies that they give is that of pouring thick oil from one pot in another pot. And this may sound a little ridiculous, but if you actually tune into that analogy, and I've used it before as a meditation, if you tune into the visualization of thick liquid oil being poured into another pot from one pot, and just imagine that there's endless oil pouring from one pot. It's an infinite pot, right? So oil keeps pouring in a steady stream from one pot into the next. If you just visualize that thick stream of oil that never ends, that just keeps on pouring, that forms this very steady, stable stream of singular consciousness, of singular attention. That's what's described as meditation. When concentration becomes more effortless, becomes more constant, becomes more under your quote-unquote control, in that sense. And then the third stage is samadhi. Samadhi stands for union, or unity consciousness. So let's say you're focused on an object or on an idea of your focus. You start concentrating on that, you start to become familiar with the vibratory signature frequency of the particular idea, reality, object, or state of being that you wish to manifest, that you wish to realize, that you wish to embody more of in your frequency field. And through concentration, it becomes more steady. You're able to actually really tune into that imagination or into that object. And that imagination becomes more vivid, becomes more constant, becomes seemingly more real. You start to feel the object. You start to feel whatever you're focused upon. Again, whether that's a state of being or an object. And samadhi is the stage where you, in a sense, lose your sense of your previous self or your previous position. So whereas concentration may still feel like, okay, I'm a body mind over here and I'm focused upon an object, in the state of samadhi or union consciousness, that imagination becomes so vivid that a certain type of, shall we say, ease or bliss starts to enter your being and you become one with the object of your focus. Your consciousness is actually so absorbed with the focus of your choice that you forget that you're actually focused from this point of view. So you become the thing you're focused upon, if that makes sense. Does that make sense? Okay, so it's simply a deep state of concentration or meditation or absorption. So together in the Yoga Sutras, they're called samyama. So concentration, meditation, samadhi are called, concentration, meditation, union, merging are called samyama, or we can call it the adept's focus in this case. So before I continue with leading you through that, just remind you that everything is vibratory in nature. Everything is vibration. And by everything, I literally mean everything. So everything you can experience, whether it is an object or a very subtle, abstract state of consciousness or a quality of being, let's say love. Many people are looking to embody the quality of unconditional love. Whatever it is, or it can be personal or a relationship or a fancy car or a fancy house or a state of non-duality or a state of union, whatever the focus is, whatever the experience is that you're looking for, it is consciousness having an experience of itself at a certain vibratory level, shall we say, or a certain frequency of being. So literally everything, the cup you're holding, the ring around your finger, the hair on your head, it's all consisting of a vibration, literally. So since literally everything is vibration, even physical matter, as well as spiritual realizations, we can start to see everything as being essentially neutral and equally valid. So every choice within the broad field of infinite possibilities that consciousness has access to, which is everything, because consciousness is the creator, the generator of all that is. So since consciousness has equal access to any particular reality of its choosing, and all is vibration, and all is the expression of the infinite one, we can start to understand that our biases, that our definitions of what is right and wrong, sort of starts to fall away for a second, or forever. Where we, in a sense, transcend our conditioning, our limited views of what works, what does not work, what we should be focusing on, what we should not be focusing on. And suddenly it becomes this wide field of everything being an equal expression of infinity, because that's what it is. In the eyes of infinity, everything is equally valid. Why? Because everything expresses a particular portion of all the possibilities in which infinity can express itself. So literally this experience is equally valid to you suffering by yourself in your room, or you focusing upon a candle flame, or you manifesting the car of your dreams. From the point of view of the one, every single moment that you are experiencing what you could call your life, the one is rejoicing because it sees it as yet another way for it to express itself through you, quote unquote, through your sense of I am. And so everything is equally valid. I share this because in order for us to really gain the freedom of focus, which is very important if you wish to generate the life of your dreams or the life of a life of clarity, a life of understanding who you are and being able to utilize that consciously instead of be ruled by all these biases that you've picked up along the way. In order to truly have free will, to truly have freedom of choice, freedom of consciousness, which you essentially do have, but you've given it away to notions and biases, we need to clear out those biases for a moment. You need to not, you can have preferences, but you need to not prefer one thing as being better than something else or being a more appropriate expression of infinity. Because infinity, again, does not see that difference. Does that make sense? The fact that the one does not blink at dark or light, does not blink at left or right, it doesn't see a difference. All it sees is more presence of itself, Oh, hey, fun, you're suffering. That's excellent. That's another way within which I can express myself, through which I can express infinite options. Oh, wonderful, you're being in joy. That's excellent. That's another way within which I can express myself, through which I can express myself. So all that you've ever experienced has positively been a contribution to the expansion of creation. So there's no mistakes in that sense. There's no sin. There's no guilt. There's no regret. Of course, you're free to choose the experience of regret. But mechanically, structurally speaking, there is no such thing as sin or regret or guilt. Again, why? Because everything that you've blamed and judged about yourself, the one has never judged that, because all it saw was, hey, another perfect expression of who I am. So just let that sink in for a moment. The fact that your entire life has been perfect. Yes, even that moment. See, as soon as you focus on what's perfect, as soon as you focus on the vibration of perfection and abundance and truth and freedom and permission and worthiness, the very next thing that comes up right after that is some kind of focus on the opposite, usually. Why? Because heightening your frequency will bring out all the things you hold on to that are not going to be able to live in that next frequency that you've just chosen by placing your consciousness upon an idea that is in a vibratory alignment with the truth of existence. So as soon as you line up your personal vibration with the vibration of your greater self, which is rooted in infinite possibilities, endless abundance, unconditional love, light, everything is seen as an expression of infinity. As soon as your thinking lines up with that, your feeling will start to feel really good. Because feelings are your barometer for how correct your thinking is, your perspective is, your way of seeing life is. So if you feel really good about what you've just been thinking or how you've been seeing life, that means that you have total permission from the entirety of existence all the way back to the one itself, infinity itself, the ingraspable, the inexperienceable one itself, to continue along that line. In fact, that is preferred. That is universally preferred. That's why it feels good. That's how the feeling works. That's how the emotional body works. That's its only purpose, is to let you know whether or not you're thinking correctly. Sounds a little bit scientific, but that's really all there is to it. If you're thinking in the wrong direction, you'll feel really bad. If you're thinking along the line of sight of your higher self or of creation itself, if your thought process is rooted in the convictions that correspond to the truths of reality itself, you'll feel really, really good. That's just how benign this creation is set up. It's a win-win situation. If you're doing the right thing, you're going to feel really good. If you're doing the wrong thing, not that there is such a thing, but if you're doing something that is actually not in everyone's best interest, you will feel really, really bad. If you're doing something that's in everyone's best interest, even if your mind cannot perceive of how that's going to benefit anyone, it just seems like it's your own pure bliss and you're being selfish. If it makes you feel in genuine bliss, and of course integrity is a part of that, because as soon as you sacrifice your integrity and you try to mess with other people's free will, you will not feel entirely good. You may feel momentary pleasure in your sort of egotistic response to that moment, but something underneath doesn't feel quite right. However, whenever you feel totally holistically pure and blissful, that is surfing all that is. That is serving everything. That's how this creation is set up. It's set up in a good way so that when you're doing the right thing, you actually feel good. Whereas most people believe, or most religions believe, or many religions believe, that if you're feeling good, you're doing the wrong thing. And if you're feeling good, or sorry, if you're feeling bad, you're somehow being of service. So get rid of that idea, because even if you're not a very religious person, I find that in our collective unconscious, this is a really prominent feeling. So even if you're not brought up with the whole sin idea, you will still find that there is a sense of unworthiness there for you to experience great degrees of bliss. Am I right? Do you ever experience this? Yes? So it's just because you have signed up to be a portion of this collective, and so you can be of service to everyone by actually lightening that portion of the consciousness, by enlightening that portion of the consciousness, by giving yourself full permission to follow your resonance with integrity, but nevertheless follow your resonance all the way through, so that you can open up to that bliss, to that true connection, to that true wisdom, to that true love, so that you feel connected to creation, to all that is. And then you're truly being of service. And then and only then will you have the means and the wisdom to know how to be of service. Does that make sense? So you got to be a little bit selfish if you wish to be selfless. Okay? All right. So everything is vibration. Consciousness shifts into different realities through changing its frequency. This is done most effectively by deliberate focus or meditation. So, in our society, we have gathered a lot of mixed, what I call mixed frequencies. Most of us consist of a lot of mixed frequencies. We're very unfocused, which is okay. I'm not trying to make you like a monk or like have you concentrate upon a single object for the rest of your life. That's very boring. It's not interesting. But what I do want you to be really clear on is when you are being out of alignment with yourself. Because when you're being out of alignment with yourself, you feel bad. And when you feel bad, that's a true signal that you're being out of alignment with the way creation actually works most efficiently. So if you wish to be efficient at being of service and being a good boy and a good girl, and if you wish to be efficient in manifesting your dreams, you have to notice when you feel good and when you don't feel good. Because that's the only means you have to actually knowing whether you're doing something that's wise or stupid. Now, many people's minds take over when they grasp to spirituality, when they grasp to certain teachings. They think they understand the concepts of the teachings, and they might very well understand these concepts. But then they gain the innocent arrogance of believing that the teachings supersede how one feels. So, in other words, one starts to place one's feelings in certain boxes that make sense from the teachings or the teacher's perspective. Now, this is a very bad mistake, even though you can't make any mistakes. It's a very bad choice because you're literally going against nature, you're going against your own stream, and you're separating yourself from true wisdom. So true wisdom requires you to be really attentive to your overall general feeling state. If your feeling state feels really holistically good, you feel abundant, you feel free, you feel loving, you feel giving, you feel like you're on top of the world, then somehow you must have aligned your frequencies, right? The moment right before that experience. Or just in general, that day, your mind or your perspective, your focus must be in alignment with something that's actually in alignment for you and therefore for all of creation. Does that make sense so far? Okay. So yeah, this is done most effectively by deliberate focus or meditation. So many of us, again, have these mixed frequencies. Therefore, focus can be quite helpful in streamlining your vibration and really getting to know the nature of consciousness and the nature of frequency and the nature of who you are as an individuated expression of the all that is consciousness. Your individuated I am consciousness is an expression, is a reflection, it's an extension of the all that is, all simultaneously in one moment, timelessly so aware of everything all at once, consciousness. You are an expression of that, an extension of that. Does that make sense? Do you feel that? Do you believe that? You cannot be separated from consciousness because you are consciousness. But you are consciousness experienced through your particular focal point of I am. Makes sense, right? Okay. So, it really helps to gain focus. Focus really helps. Deliberate attention really helps in getting to know who you are. And there's no greater pleasure in life than to know who you truly are. Than to know, we could sort of go into the philosophical realm of it and say like why you're here and what you're here to do, what your purpose is. And sometimes these ideas can be distracting. But in general, that is a correct statement. It's very liberating to know who you are and why you are here. That does not mean that you need to know exactly what you are to do specifically and when you have to do it. It's more of a general sense of clarity as to what intention did you bring with you or what theme are you here to explore. Or what primordial quality of consciousness do you most desire to be in alignment with and to be an expression of, an example of? So just for half a minute, take a deep breath, relax your thoughts, give them away, and ask yourself, why am I here? And don't go into specifics like to be a lawyer or to be a spiritual teacher or any of that, but be specific in a different way. Be specific, vibrationally speaking. So why are you here? To share what? To become more of what? What frequency? What vibration of consciousness? What quality of existence are you here to dive into more, to learn more of, and to be a more pristine example of to the rest of yourself, other selves? Just for a few seconds, tune into that question. Who are you? Why are you here? What's most important to you? And I'm assuming that you have found some type of quality, even if it's as abstract as unconditional love, which is absolutely gorgeous. It can be more specific, but it doesn't have to be. So as soon as you find a particular vibration of consciousness, a quality of existence that you feel really drawn towards, that you feel like, yes, this is what I wish to be an example of, this is what I wish to embody and exude and vibrate as. When you find that, let's go into the concentration aspect of it. So simply, place your attention on the idea that brings you into that quality of your choice. So think, in other words, simply think of the state of your choice, the frequency of your preference, your soul's preference in that sense. Bring your attention to that idea and see how maybe there may be some distractions. You may go back and forth. But overall, you have a pretty clear picture back and forth of that image, or of that sensation, or of that idea. So you bring your attention back to it again and again, you focus on it again and again. This is concentration. Now as you keep doing that, you will find that there's prolonged moments where you sort of drop into the experience of that imagination, of that focal point, and suddenly, for that moment, focus becomes effortless and continuous. Even if it's just for 5 seconds. Simply bring it back again and again to that quality. Feel it, imagine it, perceive it. And you will find that the stream of your attention becomes more constantly focused on that and less focused on your physical body here. You're becoming more non-physically focused upon the quality of consciousness of your choice. Notice this. It becomes easier and easier. Even with this single minute, it becomes easier and easier. This is meditation. You start to experience prolonged moments of continuous flow, like oil being poured from one pot into the next as a constant stream of conscious awareness of the object of your choice. Now, if you dive even further into this, and let go of your sense of self by simply being really excited, being really engaged with the focus of your choice. Really imagine the finer details of that imagination, of that quality. How would you express yourself? What would you feel like? What would it look like? What would the smile on your face look like? Really embody, absorb the quality of your choice. Really merge with it. Drop into it. Until all else fades away. And all you perceive is the pristine, crystalline vision of your focus. Like empty space being filled up only with the quality of your choosing. And you start to gently lose awareness, or even for just moments, lose awareness of you having a body, of you sitting in a room, and all you really perceive in that moment, or for those glimpses, is what it's like to be that frequency of consciousness. So imagine your preferred reality, your preferred state of being, your preferred state of circumstance. It's all one thing eventually. And completely let go into this reality. Make it more real than this one. Allow yourself to know that imagination is real. Equally as valid of a choice as physical imagination. Let those qualities blossom. Feel them, see them, be them. Act accordingly to them. And you will get glimpses of bliss, glimpses of merger, glimpses of union. Now this may take some practice, may take a few tries, But it's definitely not out of reach. You can merge with any object of your choosing, because please realize you're not a physical creature. You are a consciousness choosing to focus upon the experience of a physical creature. So you might as well, every once in a while, or even more often than not, focus upon the quality of your choosing, the non-physical quality of consciousness that you wish to very efficiently and quickly embody more of. In a sense, most people are always in a state of samadhi or merger with their physical body, even though it's a choice. So this is not a new concept to you. Whenever you feel completely identified with this reality, this physical reality, you are in samadhi, you are in union consciousness with this particular portion or option of creation. As soon as you realize that all realities are equally valid expressions of infinity, you can start choosing different experiences and let go into them, drop into them fully, make them experiential completely. When you're dreaming at night, you're in samadhi with the dream state. You forget all about your physicality. You forget all about this world. You can't even perceive it anymore. That is a form of samadhi, a form of union consciousness, unity consciousness. Simply become more masterful in this. Become more conscious of this. Because if you do not consciously choose how you think and how you feel, in other words, if you don't consciously choose your frequency of being, your quality of consciousness, you're going to get lost in what I call the substitute caretaker. Some people call it the ego effect or the ego, but it's simply the automatic mind. It's us giving away our free will to conditioned ideas and saying, well, I'm out of control. I don't know what I'm doing. I'm just a puppet. I'm just a servant. I'm just nothing. I don't know what's going on. Then the only option for your consciousness is to take care of you for you. And the only means that it has of doing so on this level of consciousness is what we call the unconscious mind, or unconscious beliefs. Beliefs that are not deliberately chosen by you. They're picked up along the way. That's why most people have mixed frequencies. And that's why most people have mixed up lives. Your life is an immediate reflection of your state of consciousness. If you clarify and crystallize your state of consciousness in accordance with your chosen focus, your chosen imagination, your chosen state of non-physicality, then the physicality will surround you in accordance with your non-physical vibratory qualities of being. So learn to take back your free will from the unconscious mind, where it seems like you're absolutely without control, to the conscious deliberate focus, until you start realizing, hey, wait a second, I am meant to be a conscious co-creator of creation. And then things start flowing for you because you start flowing in alignment with the truth of creation. Does this make sense? So it may sound more technical than it is. It's simply the flow of applying consciousness to a particular focal point and then staying with that for a moment, say for a minute or so. But choose carefully. Because what you focus upon, especially if you do it with concentration, meditation, and samadhi, or concentration, meditation, and unity consciousness, or absorption, it is very powerful in terms of it becoming part of your frequency field. And whatever is part of your frequency field, you will attract as a reflection to yourself. So learn to choose deliberately the qualities of consciousness, the state of being, that feels like it's in greatest alignment with the truth of your spirit. How do you know? You feel amazing. If you feel bad, then something is out of alignment. A very simple signal. If you feel not good, that means your thinking is incorrect. That's all it means. If you feel great, it means your thinking is correct. That's all that means. And as soon as more of your thinking is correct and more of your feeling expands into amazingness and bliss and feeling really, really good about yourself, about life, feeling in alignment, feeling connected, you start to gain greater and greater and greater and greater wisdom, greater and greater capacity to be unconditionally loving to yourself and others, and you become a clearer conduit or channel for transformation, for enlightenment, simply by being yourself, not even trying. You're not even trying. You're just following your bliss. You're just being your bliss, And through that natural state of being, being in alignment, disregarding all the thoughts that things should work differently, or even spiritual circles that teach you that desire is ego, stuff like that. Just dismiss that for a moment and just trust in the natural orchestration of the universe, which is feeling good means you're doing something right. You're in alignment with a higher way of seeing things. And of course, if you're in alignment with a higher way of seeing things, you'll be able to become a better Fezzel, well, better in a sense, more precise, more efficient at expressing unconditional love and light. Does that make sense? Good. So will you give yourself permission to enjoy life? Will you give yourself permission to be blissful? Will you start focusing more deliberately upon the qualities of consciousness that make you feel amazing? And will you remember and remind yourself that whenever you feel amazing, you feel the most connected. You feel like you are the most abundant, the most capable, the most giving, the most of service. Can you resolve the paradox of the mind where you think you have to suffer in order to be of service? And reconcile that in the vision that makes much more sense, because unity is one unity, it's one being. And why would it set up its creation, which is meant to express itself in such a way that it has to hurt itself in order to be of service to itself? Does not make any sense. So from unity perspective, you will realize that this is actually a really, really fun and carefree universe, essentially so. Now we can use that carefree freedom to make it really hard, to make it really difficult, to make it really unworthy looking. That is still done out of freedom. That's how much we are loved. That's how much we are let free, let loose. We're all loose cannons. We're all let loose, in a sense. We're portions of the Creator, and the Creator says, I trust you unconditionally. I love you unconditionally. Go express me in whatever way you see fit. Have fun, or not. And many people on this planet have chosen not to enjoy that process. We can reverse that. We can turn that around. We can make that more conscious. You're already completely manifesting your reality all the time. Your state of being is always up to you. But out of a certain type of laziness or incapacity or incapability, how do you say that? Right? Incapability. You have given this away to unconscious portions of yourself. Because if you, with your conscious consciousness, say, I don't know how to take care of myself vibrationally. I don't know how to choose who I am. I don't know how to choose what I wish to manifest around me, what I wish to express and paste onto this canvas that is literally your canvas. If you don't choose the colors that you prefer, then you basically say, okay, I take all this power and I give it away to you. Now, what is the only you that is left, apart from your higher self, but what's the only you that's left on this level? All the ideas that you picked up along the way that were never yours to begin with. In other words, everything that you did not come here for, everything that you come here not to be, you have become if you give away your power, if you give away your consciousness in that way. And then this causes all kinds of troubles, and then we have to start creating spirituality. But originally, spirituality did not exist because out of alignment did not exist. If we knew how to utilize our feeling state as a guidance compass to bring ourselves back into clarity and alignment and conscious vibrational caretaking of ourselves, we would not have generated this idea of spirituality. Spirituality does not exist. It literally does not exist. It's a phantom. It's a man-made idea. To other civilizations, what we call spirituality is just life. You're just living life. It's just who I am. Spirituality is who I am. That's life. How can there be not spirituality? How can there be something other than life? And then there's the problem that most of our spirituality is completely flawed. Absolutely, absolutely flawed. It's cute, but it's just inefficient. For some people, it may be of service for a little while, but as a comprehensive, all efficient system, we simply don't have it. It's not around. It's not very clear. So, do us all a favor and get in alignment with yourself. Because that's where the real wisdom comes from. The wisdom that we project onto spirituality and spiritual teachers and self-realization and enlightenment, the wisdom that we project onto that is just another way of giving away our own power to realize it right here, right now. It's just another way of postponing that we already know who we are, that we already know what we are, that we already know what we truly desire to be. So again, do us all a favor and be in alignment, because it will eliminate spirituality from the face of this earth. The very next stage might be that spirituality becomes common knowledge, common desire, but really the next stage is that spirituality disappears altogether. It's the stage after the next stage. So let's work on that. Let's skip a few steps and accelerate the process, because things could use some acceleration. So far, so good? Do you grasp all this? Nice, thank you. So the adept's focus is not just about focus. It is a complete package. It's dedication. It's sincerity. It's integrity. It's, most of all, integrity to your own alignment. Integrity to what spirit is desiring through you. Wanting to be of service. Yes, that's a very integral part of this focus of being an adept. But that comes naturally, you see. You already want to be of service, otherwise you would not be here, trust me. There's better places. So you're here because you want to be of service, to some extent. Sure, you want to explore your own realm. You want to explore qualities. You want to learn. But if you did not also want to be of service, you would not be here at this particular timing of consciousness, in this illusion, in this plane of its creation. So you want to be of service. How? By transforming a portion of creation, a portion of the collective, from darkness into light. How do you best do that? How do you most intimately do that? How are we most of service? This is what we call incarnation. Incarnation is you perceive a portion of the collective energy. You take that portion of the collective energy and you say, hey, this is compatible with the lessons I wish to learn to expand as a soul. So I'll be born with these parents in this location, at this age, at this timing, so that I can take this portion of the collective, make it what I call my body and my mind, while I am a consciousness, and I'm risking forgetting everything that I truly am and becoming completely identified with the portion of the collective that I take on. But I do that because I want to be of service. And then, through the process of remembering and bumping into things during life and learning from the contrast of what feels good, what does not feel good, what feels in alignment, what does not feel in alignment, what resonates, what does not feel resonant. Through that process, I learn to remember what my true spirit quality is, what I truly came here to become more of, to embody more of. And that is when you start suddenly approaching what you previously called me, as, oh, this is a portion of the collective unconscious that I took on as my vehicle of expressing myself, but now I see it as almost another. I see it as something I can observe. I see it as a challenge, as a jigsaw puzzle that I can pull apart and put together in a better way. So literally your body and your mind, your conditioned mind, consists of other people's stuff. Literally. If there was no other people's stuff, there would be no stuff for you to make a body and a mind out of. So by being here, you are being of service in the most intimate possible way, because you throw a portion of your most clear self into most absolute forgetfulness. You gamble with your life in the hopes of remembering, in the hopes of actually gaining the conscious tools. And of course you are supported, you are guided, and you have to be really, 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 really stubborn and insistent upon your personal free will wanting something else out of fear to not ever grow up, at least a little bit. But there's people that do that too. It's a fun exploration. So you take this portion of the collective, you make it your own in the most intimate way, and then from the inside out, you start enlightening yourself, you start lighting a fire. And yes, you're going to hit against all these little challenges. in order for the light to completely burn up that web of confusion and mixed frequencies, and to become one singular light expression of infinity. Powerful, godlike, in its ability to manifest, to create, to generate its own state of being, and through that, generate its environment and influence its environment in the most beautiful way. You all do that in your own way. So you're always being of service. So you can't go wrong. You're already perfect. You're being a good girl. You're being a good boy. Don't worry. Regardless of what mommy says, regardless of what daddy says, mommy doesn't know shit. Daddy knows even less. So listen to what feels good. What feels good knows the most. What feels holistically good knows the most. What makes you feel truly connected knows the most. That's where your source of information should come from. Your intuition, your true connected state of being, which when connected to consciously, will always make you feel good because it's a rewarding system. It's a blissful, self-love-making system. This universe is constantly making love to itself, or at least attempting to, through all of you. Whenever you feel good, you're making love with existence. Whenever you feel bad, you're rejecting existence. You're resisting existence, which is fine. You're still loved. You're unconditionally loved. But it just doesn't feel as good, and it's not as efficient, and it doesn't accelerate your theme as much. If you start accelerating, you can infuse within the same lifetime vehicle expression multiple lifetimes worth of lessons and expressions. Whereas if you are completely oblivious from birth on onward till your death, you might have to take 10 lives just like that to express one life's worth of lessons and expansion. But since you are all here, I take it that you are paying attention. At least to some extent. So that is good. That is applaudable. That is great. That's beautiful. And I thank you. I thank you for listening. And I thank you for opening up to spirit, to higher wisdom, to resonance, to what feels good. And to an extent, to what I have to share. I appreciate that. Purity, service, and balance helps to achieve higher states of focus and union more easily. What do I mean by purity and service? Let's just focus on purity. I think I've dealt with the service aspect. Purity and balance. What is purity? Purity can be experienced as the immediate result, as the immediate effect that the intention to be pure has on your consciousness. Simply that. Just intend to be the highest purity you can be. What would that look like? What would that feel like? Imagine that. Again, this is like any other thing, realization, goal, or vibration. It's all vibratory states of consciousness. It's all consciousness generating a different frequency experience of itself. That's all you'll ever experience, is consciousness having a particular frequency experience of itself. It's all you can ever experience. There is no exceptions. Enlightenment is not outside of these rules. Materialism is not outside of these rules. It's all consciousness vibrating, experiencing itself. You can never experience matter. You can only experience what you have to say about it. Have you ever noticed that? You never experience the actual thing or the actual car or the actual house. You only experience your belief about how good or bad that is. Oh, this is an amazing house. You feel amazing. Oh, this is a terrible house. You feel terrible. The house is not terrible. The house is not amazing. You only ever experience what you say it is, and it's always what you say it is. Because physicality is nothing but an empty smoke and mirrors reflection of your state of being. So all there is consciousness having a frequency state of being experience of itself. And the state of being can be, I would say, manipulated, but I don't mean that in a negative way. I mean it can be controlled, it can be mastered, it can be understood. When you start to understand how consciousness and frequency works, life suddenly becomes much more enjoyable. It becomes a game that's under your control. And by control, I mean it in the most holistic possible way. Control is another word for me as alignment. We only think we need control. We only are needy for control if we don't believe we have it, you see? Once we know that we're in complete control of how we feel, how we think, how we experience life, if we know that we are masters of our own creation, of our own state of being, then suddenly there is no need for control. There is no need for controlling. There is no need for manipulating in that sense. We only need to do these things as compensations for not knowing that we're in control. That's why we need to absolutely know that we are in control. It's the only way we can live as peaceful, pure beings of light. You have to know you're in control. Whenever you feel disempowered, you're going to express that in some ways. It's what we could call the ego effect. It's not an actual thing, it's an effect. You put water and sunshine together, you get the rainbow. Pull away one of these two, the rainbow no longer exists. Ego does not exist. It's an effect. It's an effect. You generate it or you don't generate it. It's not something that lingers that you need to deal with. Oh, I have this ego here. There's no ego anywhere. It's an effect. Stop generating one of the qualities or one of the ingredients that recipe we call the ego effect needs, and the whole ego effect is gone. No trace. Sure, it may be regenerated, but then you regenerate the effect. It's not actually there when you're not creating it. So there's not two of you. There's not you consciousness and then you the ego. Does that make sense? There's only you consciousness either generating an ego effect within its consciousness or not generating an ego effect and generating whatever it desires. Here's the irony. If you choose only what you desire, if you choose only to feel how you desire to feel and express yourself as you desire to express yourself and generate or go for the things that you truly resonate with, there is no space left in your consciousness to generate the compensating substitute servant, because that comes from unconsciousness. It comes from giving away your power. It comes from not owning your reality. So that's the tricky part also of spiritual teachings that talk about eliminating the ego or avoiding the ego or not feeding the ego with desire. They don't understand that to suppress desire is the perfect fuel for the ego effect. To embrace desire is the end of generating the ego effect. It's ironic, but you have to understand that humans are very feeble-minded. They're very stupid. On a mental level, on an intellectual level, on a conscious thinking level, they're very, very stupid. You have to understand this. If you don't remember this, you'll fall prey to becoming a sheep. Thank you. And you don't want that shit. It's not good. It does not feel good. You want to be in alignment. You want to be empowered. You want to be powerful. Every human being craves for power. And then spirituality comes along and says, don't do that. And it only makes it worse. That's why spiritual seekers always seek for 20, 30 years. It's because it doesn't work. Duh. Does it make sense? If something doesn't work, you can continue to do it for 30 years with no real results. If something works, it's done in a few days. So do what actually works, which is to embrace the quality of being that you are, which is guided to you through desire. You have to be radical in that way. You have to be willing in that way. You have to be fearless in that way. And I promise you, if you are fearless in following your desire with integrity, what does integrity mean? Integrity means that you understand, that you know, that you don't have to deprive anyone else of what they desire in order to get what you desire, in order to be what you desire to be. There is no conflict in this infinite parallel universe's reality. Everything can coexist. So you go your way, let others go their way, and you be as powerful and as beautiful and as magnificent and as enjoyable to yourself as you can be. When you are so connected to a high vibratory state of being that you cannot generate the ego effect, you cannot generate misery, you will only generate wisdom and love. You cannot do that through suppression, elimination, minding your thoughts all the time from a negative point of view. Oh, it's this ego. Don't segregate yourself. Integrate yourself. Whatever the ego is, if it is even anything, it's a call for help. It's a call for embracing your power. It's a call for listening to what you truly desire. In that sense, it's your ally. If you notice you're going a little off course, you're becoming a little manipulative, a little controlling, a little negative in nature, then it's simply a good thing. It's calling you to remember that you are powerful, that you don't need to meddle with reality, because you create reality. One who knows that they create their reality don't have to meddle with the small things inside of that reality. It would be redundant, it would be inefficient. You generate all that you see from right here, so stay right here. Don't go out there and try to fix it. Fix it right here. How do you fix it right here? Feel good. Do whatever you need to do to feel good, again with integrity, but do whatever you need to do to feel good. Focus on whatever you want to focus on that makes you feel in alignment with the universal principles of creation. Abundance, infinity, endlessness, unconditional love, light, expressing the one. Joy, bliss, happiness, excitement. Your ability to create, I can, I am, not I am not and I can't. Those are very destructive ideas. They only suppress you more until you start shooting kids in the school. It's all expressions. All the negativity, quote unquote, that we see in the world are just expressions of us suppressing our desire. So please don't ever suppress your desire. Just find a creative, integrity-honoring way to fully embody that state of connection. That's all it is. Desire connects us to who we are. And when we fully embrace it, we feel so powerful that all the fears and lack beliefs start to disappear from view. And when they disappear from view, we can no longer access the portion of us that is given away to the unconscious that then tries to compensate for a lack of vibrational control. We only need situational control if we lack vibrational control. Does that make sense? So become really controlling on the vibrational level, so that you don't have to be controlling at all on a situational level. Does that sink in? Does that make sense? It's not a bad thing to be in control, because after all, a vibration that is, because after all, you are consciousness that has been given the free will to control its frequency. By control, I mean choice. You have choice. So when you choose to focus, to concentrate, meditate, and integrate the qualities of your preference, you will become these qualities, and they will reflect themselves in your environment. So when you think of purity, you start to feel really, really good. You start to feel really, really centered. What is purity? What is it? It doesn't matter necessarily what it is. What is it to you? What is purity? Clear? Nice. Clear. Any other keywords that come up for you? When you think of purity, the purest state you can be in right now, as a being, as an expression of infinity, oh, what?
Grace and ease.
Ease?
And grace.
Grace and ease, beautiful. What else?
Truthful.
Doubtless. Doubtless.
Innocence.
Innocence.
Total. Total.
Total. Accurate.
Accurate, nice.
Impeccable.
Impeccable.
Self-appreciative.
Self-appreciative, ooh!
Flawless.
Flawless. Doesn't that feel good? That's because they are true qualities. They are truths. That's why they feel good when you think of them. So whatever purity represents to you, whatever clarity or doubtlessness or confidence or connection represents to you, concentrate, meditate, and merge with that as frequently as you desire to do so, as frequently as it feels juicy to do so, as it feels fruitful to do so. Is there space in your consciousness right now to focus a little bit more on one of these qualities? To bring it a little bit more into your energy field, so to speak. Probably, no? There's always more room for more expansion. So simply ask yourself that question at least 12 times a day. What is important to me right now? What can I do to focus upon the state of being until it feels blissful to me right now? Focus on the good feeling state. Focus on whatever feels the most pure, the most doubtless, the most amazing, the most worthy, the most connected to the vibrational qualities of the universe, such as abundance, infinity, unconditional love, etc. 12 times a day, all the way to the point where it starts to actually merge with your vibratory field. And you know that because suddenly an imagination becomes a reality. It clicks in. You start to feel it. Remember the process I described a few weeks ago? See it, feel it, be it. It's also in the academy. See it, feel it, be it. Does that make sense? You see it. The seeing it is taking yourself as you've assumed yourself to be here and now, and you imagine something that's in a parallel reality, in another plane of visibility, another level of frequency. And from your assumed identity here, you see it. You imagine it. This is where concentration starts a little bit. These are heavy terms, but I just mean you see it. You visualize it, right? It's easy enough. Everyone can do that. So you see it. As soon as you start seeing it more and more, you start to feel it. This is where concentration kicks in. concentration, or sorry, meditation, where concentration becomes more meditative, when it becomes more whole, it starts to trickle down, it starts to be downloaded into your state of consciousness as the feeling state, the vibratory state of being. Does that make sense? That is meditation, in a sense. Samadhi, or merger, or unity consciousness, would be where you start to feel that reality to such an extent that it starts to feel more real than the feeling reality you've associated with this present personality self in this particular reality plane. So when you see it, and then you start feeling it to an extent where you start to be it, and you start to act according to it, and you start to completely believe in it, it's completely convinced that that is what is more truthful, that that is who you are. Then, boom, something happens. It clicks in, literally, it clicks in. What is that clicking in sensation? It comes with a sense of freedom, a sense of joy, a sense of empowerment, a sense of bliss, a sense of ecstasy, a sense of excitement. Suddenly the feelings become so real that you start to feel like you're on top of the world, because you are. You are the creator of reality, so you're literally on top of the world. You're simply knowing it in that moment. That's why it feels so good, because you're being truly yourself, freely yourself, with no need to control your environment, because you're in absolute control of your state of being. So when you're being it, and it clicks in, literally what it is, it's your consciousness shifting into, that's the clicking in, shifting into a parallel, coexistent, already existent version of your personality self, I am expression of all that is. There is infinite versions of you, and you can click into those infinite versions of you, which have different pasts and different futures and different circumstantial realities and different understandings of who they are, different convictions. You can click into those alternate realities through seeing it, feeling it, and then being it. And when you be it, it will start to be reflected in your environment. And that's what we call manifestation or law of attraction. But really all it is you shifting into an alternate reality where the very thing that you thought you desired is either already there, or it looks different than you thought, but some true representation of your true state of being is now there because it already exists. Anything you can ever desire already exists. Coexists with this moment. There's no time. There's no future. There's no past. It's all one moment of consciousness. Pick your frame. Pick your reality. Pick the reality that you can most authentically express your true nature through. Okay? The adept's focus is free from dogma or limitation, and can be used to realize anything, spiritual, mystical, or materialistic in nature. To the one, there is no difference. Again, everything is vibration. Free from dogma or limitation, the focus that I'm talking about is that of the free agent. What is the free agent? Awareness is infinity's free agent. It's the absolute freedom that the one gives to awareness to utilize its infinite intelligence to express infinity in whatever way it sees fit. We all share in this free agency, this free will, this free power. You have adopted a portion of that. All levels of your being, because all levels of creation, and you are creation, so all levels of your being have free will on their own level, have free agency, have free choice at their own level. Now they differ from different levels to each other. That's why it may sometimes seem like you don't have free will, but you do on the level from which it is given to you, as well as from the level of which it is received. You have the free will of how you receive your creation that you chose to give to you. Does that make sense? There is no God apart from you that decides for you. The God apart from you that decides for you is you. Just on a different level, vibratory state of your consciousness. As soon as you start to increase your level of consciousness, as soon as you realize that you have free focus, you start to vibrate, literally vibrate your consciousness at a higher rate, at a higher speed. And you therefore become more expanded in your awareness of who you truly are. And you start to become closer to that level of what we could generally call the higher self. Whatever term you have for it is fine. Or we can even call it God. Now, there's distinctions in that to me, but that doesn't matter. Just a greater self that you become more of a channel to. Not from here, but because you actually move on to become more like it. So it's not so much that you even become more, although we could say that, but it's not even that you as a personality become more transparent to the greater self, that you become a better servant, less sinful. It's more that you actually become more like it. You raise in the vibratory state of consciousness. So you start to become more like your higher self is, and see more like it sees, and act more like it would act. Does that make sense? Awesome. So anything that brings you joy makes you wiser. Remember that. The adept's focus means you can simply tune into anything with crystal clarity and one point of desire, and merge your vibrations with the vibrations of your chosen focus. The adept's consciousness becomes highly fluid, malleable, flexible, and directed or directable. Sounds good? No? No. Yeah? No? Do you like me to talk about automobiles and trains and planes? Or would you like me to talk to you about who you are and the power that you have? Yes? Okay, thank you. Don't be too excited, okay? Are there any questions? I'll take that as a good sign. So either if you want to sit there, that's fine. If you're going to sit here, you'll be on camera, just so you know, which you can do. You're absolutely welcome to. I invite you to. But otherwise, we can give you the microphone and you can ask your question from there. Perfect.
Hi. Hello.
If you hold that button for about a second. Okay, there you go.
Hi, I'm Karna.
Cheers.
Cheers. So we've been playing with these ideas for a while. And
who's we?
Me and my friend, Kelly.
Hey, friend. Cheers.
So there's a lot of discussion around core desired feelings and the feeling state, and you're talking about aligning first with your thought and then how that generates the feeling.
Yes.
And other teachings are, could you start with a feeling? Why would you, you're being very specific, and I love your masculine one-pointed directedness, but for me it's just like, it just feels like hierarchy. And how can you talk a little bit about your version of order, of how things are generated?
I'm not sure this is what you mean, but let me know. So I made a schematic once. I don't think any... Does anyone have it here by any chance? The point of view, believe, thoughts? No? Okay, cool. So this may not be what you mean, but imagine... Oops. There is a whiteboard if I want to. That's true, yeah. Very quickly. Thanks, man. Cool. This is not it. Nice. Thanks. This is a circle, and it says I am. So that is your base state of consciousness. Everyone can sense that they exist right now, right?
Yes.
It's pretty undeniable. You hear my voice, you hear my question, you're able to confirm, you're able to think about it in whatever way you want to think about it. So you exist, right? Everything pre-requires that you exist. Every time you complain about existence, it's a confirmation of your existence. Every time you rejoice in existence, it's a confirmation of your existence, correct? Every time you experience whatever is a confirmation of existence. So if you want to be enlightened, to put it real simply, simply start utilizing every experience. And you can do this for 7 days straight and you'll be enlightened. So for 7 days straight, at least 12 times a day, ideally 25 times a day, you recognize very clearly, you pause your mind for 2 to 5 seconds, just empty sky-like presence for just a moment. And you notice that you exist. And now you continue throughout the day to notice that no matter what you experience, Whether you feel bad, whether you feel good, whether you think something or not think something, whether someone says something nice or something not nice, or nothing at all, or everyone ignores you, doesn't matter. Every moment, every experience is a confirmation of awareness, is it not? And with that, a confirmation that you exist. If you didn't exist, you could not experience. Correct? Okay, so you're enlightened? Then let's move on. Can everyone see this a little bit? So this little dot is the I am, and it has a point of view. Does that make sense? I am always has a point of view on life. Whether the point of view, if the point of view is in alignment with some of the vibrational truths of creation, I am starts to feel really good. If the point of view is out of alignment with some of the universal truths, it starts to feel really bad. That's the guidance mechanism of the emotional body. Again, that is all that the emotional body is here to do. Again, psychotherapy becomes completely redundant. Not saying it's not helpful for some people at certain times. I'm saying it would be completely redundant had we understood this program, this mechanism. So, when consciousness, which is you, I am consciousness, when the I am consciousness chooses a certain point of view on existence, this can be an idea, it can be a perspective, it can be an angle on life, it can be something as, let's say, in human terms, that would translate itself as, for example, wow, this is a really amazing job opportunity. It's a perspective. It's a point of view. So your point of view is, wow, this is a really amazing opportunity. So you're in the vibratory state of amazing opportunity. Feels good, right? Has nothing to do with the job. You feel good, not because there is a job. Jobs don't exist. You feel good because you're in a vibratory state of consciousness that is in alignment with the truth of reality, which is everything is an abundant, amazing opportunity. So therefore, you feel good. That was just to clarify the emotional body once again. But what happens if the same point of view is reiterated? If it becomes believed in, it turns into a belief. So beliefs, beliefs are actually the same thing as the point of view, but the point of view is on a more non-physical level than beliefs. In other words, when a point of view is believed in, when it becomes conviction, when you be it, when you become that point of view, like when you see something and then you start to feel it and then you start to become it and then you become convinced of it. That's when consciousness locks in its point of view, and when it locks it in, it becomes, it takes, in energetic terms, it takes on a slightly more structured existence. So it becomes slightly more quasi-physical. It's still not physical because we can't see beliefs, we can't touch it and eat it. In a way, we can. But beliefs are the slightly more physicalized or crystallized version of a point of view, of a vibration. Does that make sense? Ultimately, this is where your level of control is at, and ideally, that's where we bring it to. We become masters of our point of view. We become masters of how we choose to see life. So that's what I mean when I say choose your state of being, choose your thought, choose your perspective, choose how you wish to feel and experience life, etc. Now, when beliefs are crystallized, it starts to generate nasty little buggers, which are also known as emotions. Nothing wrong with emotions, obviously. Emotionality is beautiful. But emotions are actually, in a sense, unnecessary, as we have elaborated upon them. I'm not saying emotionality is redundant. Emotionality is absolutely crucial to who we are. It's our guidance system. But emotions, as we have created them to be, and it's perfectly fine that we have, I'm just saying that in an alternate reality where we would have understood this more, emotions would not quite look the way they look today. It would be more a pure state of constant bliss, excitement, and using emotionality as a very clear and immediate guidance system. There would not be envy and jealousy and anger and all these things. That's why I say psychotherapy would be, in this reality, redundant. If you feel like going to psychotherapy, please honor that feeling. Disclaimer. You should see the emails I get sometimes. So beliefs are crystallized points of view of existence, right? When certain circumstances, let's say circumstances, when circumstances happen, they trigger us. So like, here's that little guy, Andrew. Yes, sweetie. Yes, I can do that. Thank you. Okay, my drawings are going to look much better now. When circumstances happen and they start reflecting our paradigm, our belief system, often we think that thoughts trigger emotions, right? But they actually don't, in my experience. Beliefs trigger emotions. Thoughts can trigger beliefs, which then trigger emotions. But you cannot have an emotion about something, and I'm not talking about emotionality, I'm talking about emotions, like defined, oh, this is how I feel right now. You cannot have these if you don't have any beliefs about a certain thing. For example, who feels really emotional right now about that doorknob? Anyone? How about now? Anyone? Do you feel anything? You don't feel anything about something that you don't have any beliefs about. Does that make sense? So that's why reality is so subjective. And when we think that we're experiencing a circumstance, we actually don't ever experience a circumstance. You cannot experience a tree. I'm so sorry to break the news. In a sense, you can, but when it comes to emotionally experiencing a tree, all that you experience is what you believe about the tree, how you choose to see the tree. So really, all that you ever experience is I am consciousness having a certain vibratory point of view experience of life. What is life? Life is nothing but empty smoke and mirrors reflecting this. So even when you think you're touching a tree, all you really experience from consciousness point of view is still your point of view about that self-generated image. Does that make sense? And you can start to really see this because you don't feel anything about so much that's happening right now simultaneously. All of creation is happening right now. Do you feel anything about it? No, you only feel something about what I'm telling you, what you're aware of, and what your beliefs about that are. If you don't like what I'm saying, you're going to feel bad, and you're going to say, oh, bad teacher. If you really like what I'm saying, you're going to say, oh, Lord, nice. So beliefs are crystallized versions of points of view, and circumstances reflect or trigger certain thoughts and beliefs that then trigger your emotions. So your emotions let you know whether your belief is in or out of alignment with your true higher self's consciousness purpose. And I can't really explain that very well in physical terms, how that works, how the I am includes like a theme and a blueprint and a focus and its own type of awareness. So for now, just call it generally the I am overall greater self awareness. When your point of view, your personalized chosen point of view and belief, therefore, is not in alignment with who you actually are on this deeper higher self level, you will be made to feel really bad. And when these do suddenly line up with your true self, you start to feel really good. Does that make sense? What was your question?
Is there a hierarchy of one starting before another?
Right, that's what, okay. So in a sense, yes, I am, then this, then this, then this, then this. Circumstance. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
Okay, does that answer your question?
Let's say yes
too.
For now. So, I will keep it right here. Right, okay. Here we go. I've seen them do this. It makes it look very foolish, but it works. So, I hear what you're saying, and I'm curious about, as I've been practicing, I have a somatic therapist who I love, and as I've been experiencing the beyond state of things and items and beings and people beyond my belief systems about them,
nice.
Would that relate to the merging that you were talking about earlier, or versus like the
In a sense, because you're quite literally losing your point of view for another point of view, and that the other point of view comes with different sensations and different realities and different. And in a sense, if the vibratory state of your chosen, newly chosen point of view, its literal vibration is much higher than your previous chosen point of view, then you have a greater sense of merger with things or environment, or you have less of a separate sense, you have less of a lacking sense, and more of an abundant merger, all of this is my own body kind of sense. So you can actually, in that sense, you can start to feel the tree, even though it's an emptiness projection of energy. You can start to feel the tree vibration, in a sense, outside of just your point of view of it, even though that is still your point of view, it's just a point of view on a much higher vibrational level. Does that make sense?
Yes.
Okay.
And then, is there, I'm interested in the oneness consciousness as the ultimate. You know, if because we're making an assumption that we're all striving for the merging in which you lose the self and which becoming one, as I understand it from your point of view.
Like it's one goal. I don't judge any purpose because or any desire, because any desire is the most authentic guidance point from the one to the being. So if we wish to truly honor the one, we have to honor our desire. And that's again where the mind can take over, take on a teaching, oh, it's all about oneness, it's all about losing the lower self. But then when the mind takes that on and it forgets to honor its intuition, its desire, then it can get lost in its own thought process, it can get lost in its own ego effect. So we need to honor what truly genuinely feels amazing, feels connected, feels most expanded. So if for you that is something other than losing your lower self in the all that is, then you should honor that. So I have no judgment of what anyone desires. So I won't say there is an ultimate goal. I just say that every goal is equally valid from the one's point of view. And how it communicates that to each of its beings is unique. You have to understand that the one, which is even beyond I am, by the way, the one is, let me just finish that then. Can everyone see this? Underneath the I am is the all that is, and there's infinite levels between the all that is and the I am, but I don't have space to draw that. And then beyond the all that is where creation starts. Everything above this line is creation, is awareness, having an experience of itself. Everything below that line is indescribable, beyond experiencing. It is the infinite source from which all that is comes. So this is, you could draw a black hole here. Or you could say this is the Big Bang that starts right here. Boom. And what was I saying? I was saying something. What was it? Yes, but before that I was saying something. Before I started drawing, I was saying something.
Oneness.
Yes, thank you. So you have to understand that the one does not care about it realizing itself, because it's beyond experiencing. It is the one, it's infinite. It doesn't care the way we care. And again, that's where a sense of spirituality can become like, oh, I need to realize the one that's the highest, that's the ultimate. The one doesn't give a shit. Whatsoever, doesn't care whatsoever if you realize the one or not. In a sense, it's inaccurate. There's so many paradoxes, it's hard to talk about. From one point of view, it doesn't care at all. From another, it completely cares. But let's just take on the point of view that it doesn't care for just a second, just to clarify certain ideas. when we, in this section of ourselves, get all wrapped up in, oh, I need to realize the one, I need to lose all this, we're forgetting that the one generated this for a reason. Not so much to be itself, because this is already itself on its own level. It generated this to express itself. It generates this to fill up a hole that wasn't there yet, which is infinity in form, or in expression, or in experience of itself. It can't experience itself without awareness generating experiences. So it needs awareness, all that is consciousness, and then it needs many agents of the ultimate free agent, all that is, or awareness is the ultimate free agent. The I am is the individuated free agent, which there are infinite of. One of them is you, congratulations. And you then choose your frequency that then manifests itself as beliefs, emotions, thoughts, and environment, or physicality, or what seems to be physicality to us, or environment. It can also be non-physical environment, such as in your dream state, still generated by a play of all this. So what is most important, in a sense, to the one is to express as much as you can. And through expressing as much as you can, you will be completely in alignment with who you truly are, so that when this is all in alignment, in a sense, and this all matches up, then what happens is this. And you, as the free agent, can move up and down and up and down and go to whatever level you want to. Recognize all of them simultaneously, and you have the freedom to play. So by being really in alignment with who you are on an expressionate level, or the yang, you automatically realize the yin, or you automatically also start activating the, in a sense, energy pathway that goes back to source. So the further, the more confident you move from source, in confidence of source, the more you will also realize more of source. Does that make sense? So if you get too wrapped up in the idea from this level of your insistent personality consciousness, from your limited view, you bypass what feels good and what does not feel good because you think you're smarter than the universe. And you start thinking that, oh, non-duality is what you need to realize. The true one is what you need to realize. For some people, that's a genuine desire at certain moments of their life. I know it is for me. I know it was for me. It still is. So yes, absolutely, when this feels resonant, ooh, sink all the way back into infinity. Lose yourself as much as you can. Absolutely beautiful. But don't get insistent upon making this some kind of achievement. Because when you do, and you bypass what actually feels in resonance, then you're not honoring, you're blocking this whole, you're creating this bottleneck experience, and you're not actually realizing more of it than you could otherwise. Does that answer your question?
Yes. So to wrap up.
I like
up,
you. What else?
So would you say that the black hole symbolism here, yes, is the Big Bang also could be said to be the forgetting in which the one forgets itself out of its...
The thing is, it doesn't even know itself. So it can't forget itself.
Okay.
It can only know itself through you. It can know itself through what it's doing right now. That's why it's doing what it's doing. Because somehow, out of its infinite intelligent potential, like one cannot know itself.
But why do you say you have to remember then?
Well, it's not even so much remember, it's almost like you're doing it for the first time, although you don't, because on this level you've already many times realized that there is the one and what you are, etc. But on this level, you need to remember what you already realized on this level and then make it active so that you can express more fully. But this, the one, does not know itself by itself. It only knows itself in reflection of awareness. By the very fact that there is presence, that there is awareness, it can start to realize, oh, what's even beyond that? Awareness can, in a sense, either be reflective of experiences or reflective of infinity. When it turns around, in a sense, when awareness turns around and asks itself, what was there before I was aware? You can practice concentration, meditation, samadhi on that too. Just keep the idea of what is before consciousness or beyond consciousness in your consciousness and see if you can start to sense a glimpse of endlessness, infinity, foreverness, nothing ever happened, no experience. And then you get you start to get in touch with infinity, or the one. Does that make sense?
Are you sure you want to answer that? Ask me that?
Does it make sense?
Yes, it makes sense. Okay. Thank you very much.
Any other questions?
Yes, I do, but I will now, I appreciate you bringing it into this whole, it was just very, very, just really, I can't, now I'm Swedish, and I'm, for whatever reason, I'm getting all my Swedish words here in my head.
Cool.
Must be some...
European.
Yeah, right? So just thank you. I appreciate you going all the way there.
My pleasure. Thank you. Anyone else? Yeah.
Is this working?
Is the green light on?
Yeah.
Okay.
So my question is, I'm coming from a Buddhist background.
Why?
It's like something that I've studied and practiced.
Okay. But are you? Is that you right now?
It's kind of like my map, like this map.
Okay, cool.
And so, I guess my question is, I don't think it's just Buddhism, but I think in Eastern spirituality, like the manifest world is like illusion, a dream, like you're saying.
Sure, yeah.
But it's not given a lot of importance then.
Right.
The importance is given to realizing this infinity.
Yes.
Or this one, or this true nature. Or. And so, I guess my question is, that doesn't always feel good to me, and I like how you speak about manifesting and expressing. And
Lovely. So follow that.
So
it feels good. So you would like me to comment on that a little bit?
Yeah.
Okay. Illusion doesn't mean that it's not relevant. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
Often people say, well, it's illusory, therefore it's not relevant. But those are two completely different things. Yes, this is completely an illusion. Does it make it not relevant? No, otherwise it wouldn't be here. If you're saying that this is an illusion, again, spirituality has so much flawed logic. So, with all due respect, because it's man-made, that's why it's so flawed. It's not because it's made by infinite intelligence, it's made by human brains that try to interpret infinity. Very flawed system. I'm not saying I'm any different, but... Yes, this is all illusory, but if we say this is all illusory and we should only honor the one, then basically we're saying that which the one created, it did out of being stupid.
Right.
Right?
And that's exactly what a lot of these teachings
the arrogance.
Are saying.
It's so beautiful. Not you. I was talking about those teachings. The arrogance of those teachings to say, and just the flawed logic, really, oh, this is all an illusion, it's created by the one, but let's just focus on the one because this is all irrelevant. It just created it because it had a bad day. Infinite intelligence doesn't create any redundancy. So if there is an illusion, you better take it to heart because it's there for a purpose, it's there for a reason. You better learn from it. You better observe it. You better investigate. You better get clear on it. You better play with it. You better manifest it. You better create with it. Then you're actually honoring the one by being humble enough to do your job, which is to follow your joy. So doing your actual job is actually a beneficial thing. It's a win-win situation because it feels good. Not doing your job like becoming a monk, unless that's actually of your resonance, unless that's actually the way you wish to express yourself. But if that's not the case, and so many people try to replicate being a monk in some form, or being a yogi, or being a siddhi, or whatever, sadhu, then you're actually not honoring the one. If you really, really, really are in love with the one, and you really want to be selfless, you have to be selfless enough to honor why it created you. And so when you honor why it created you, the portal will open and you will start to more experientially know infinity, know the one.
Yeah. I mean, I feel like you've talked about this a lot. That was just the question that keeps coming up for me.
Sure, it's good. It's a good question because many people deal with that.
Yeah.
Any other questions regarding that or regarding anything else?
No.
Cool. Okay. Anyone else? Either way, we'll address both. Doesn't matter which order. You can go first. The one doesn't care.
Hi, Bentinho.
Hey, love. Nice to see you. Nice to meet you in the flesh.
Okay. Hi. I really didn't have a question until... You said the word flawed premise.
Yes.
You're picking up a lot
flawed
on that.
Flawed logic.
Yeah. So it's amazing. Everything you've said resonates. And I've realized that when I get into a state of consciousness, it's so easy to just be blissful in imagining. I've always asked myself the question, why do I have the ability to imagine? And,
yeah.
You know, nice. It's just like, but let's get a bit practical. I do okay. have moments of...
I love when people say that. No, I love your teaching, yeah. but let's get real.
No, but I, well, no, not real in the sense, but I had my question, you're going to let me...
I've got money in my bank account, it's not that much. I've got my wife at home.
When I stumble across a... If you can give some clarity, and when you stumble across... Because this is what I hear a lot of people always asking me, and I don't really know how to make that as clear.
Okay.
I mean, I know how to, I experience it, but I love the way you are able to articulate things in a different way. So what I'm looking for is like uncluttering flawed premises. Mm-hmm. So there's really nothing wrong with a negative emotion.
Mm-hmm. It's a guidance okay. thing.
So there's really nothing wrong with a negative emotion. However, yes. a lot of people bash themselves over the head every time they feel a negative emotion. So while they're doing this imagination and creating and being blissful, the state of consciousness then moves because reality hits, and now all of a sudden is feeling that that's not possible,
yeah.
or you know, a limiting a belief. So a negative emotion hits. I've never heard you speak about the moment the negative emotion hits. What would you recommend in that moment? I've identified a negative emotion. Now I kind of like go with it. Like I kind of a lot of people like you know, lean towards it. And then snapping out of it. Sometimes I can't snap out of it. I take a nap. You know, Abraham says take a nap, or you know, something like that. So, what would you in that moment? You felt negative emotions, yeah?
Yes. Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
So.
I always love it when people say that too. Like.
All right. So in that particular moment, I've realized it. What is it like? Is there like a practical moment that you could like give some kind of speak?
Speak?
Yeah. Speak. So.
Pig, do it now. Yes. Well, first of all, you observe it, but you already did that, otherwise you wouldn't have noticed it, right? So you notice it, and you notice that it doesn't feel good. And the first thing you say to that is, wonderful. That means that my guidance system is operational. It means that I'm being shown how to live in a more holistic, amazing, aligned reality. So your only understanding of a negative emotion is that it's a positive event to see the negative emotion, right? And you see it, which means you're not it. It means you've already ascended into a higher level of consciousness, otherwise you would not be able to see the negative emotion. You would simply be it. You'd be lost in it. You wouldn't be able to notice, oh, hey, I have a negative feeling come up. So since you're as calm and collected when a negative emotion comes up, as you all are, unswayed by the appearances in consciousness. You understand that if you feel bad, it shows you that right the second before that, a belief was activated either by your environment or by your thinking process, and that fundamental belief or point of view is simply no longer working for you. That's all it is.
So basically, every time I feel a negative emotion, I'm about to discover a flawed premise. Is that the...
And to take it one step further, you're about to enter into a more heavenly reality. So who would not want to see a negative feeling? That's how people often sell themselves short in a sense, by, okay, so they're accelerating and they're feeling good, and then a negative emotion arises. And what do? They don't understand that they can reply to that in whatever way they desire. So they think, oh, wait a second, a negative emotion comes up, so that defines who I am. I'm still a sucker. I'm still bad. I'm still flawed. I'm still wrong. I still don't get how this works. No, you perfectly get how it works. That's why it comes up. Does that make sense? If you didn't get how it works, you're like many other people are, which is in a constant state of semi-depression, but it's so constant. You know, like people that either drink a lot of alcohol or do whatever substance you use a lot, at some point you become very tolerant to it. And I'm not saying this in any way negatively, but just as an analogy for the emotional state of many human beings. Whatever you do all the time, at some point it's just like you're numb to it. So you're numb to even your depression. You're depressed even towards your depression. You don't even care about your depression anymore. You don't even notice the waves. You're just like, yeah, that's life. It's bricks and cement, and I hit my head every once in a while, and I navigate around it, and that's life. So... it's a good thing when negative emotion spikes up. It's a good thing. The contrast is a good thing because it shows you that you are very active on a level of consciousness. You're very conscious. You're very progressive in your evolution, right? So it's a good sign. Always, as soon as a negative emotion hits, like, let your first response be, oh, jolly, fun, something along those lines. Does that make sense? So be really happy to see a negative feeling. Sure, it can feel a little bad, but that's okay. You've had it before. It's not that big of a deal. And now at least you know that it's arising because you're increasing your frequency. You're expanding, therefore your contraction is shown. If you're growing and you're becoming more and more muscular, like I am, then you, you, at some point, you, you burst out of your skin, right? Your jacket no longer fits. Ah, sorry, I didn't mean to. I'm not sorry. Your jacket no longer fits when you grow too fat or whatever. But when you expand too much, at some point you hit that barrier, that vibrational barrier. And what is that? It's literally you rubbing up against the very edge of your present paradigm. So your energy starts to expand even beyond your paradigm bubble, but you can't fully stretch further unless you look at the things you're holding on to that are part of the old paradigm. Now, there's many things in the old paradigm that you don't need to look at. They won't come up for you as you expand into your joy. This is where shadow work goes wrong. It focuses on all the nitty-gritty little details, 9 out of 10 which you never have to look at. Unnecessary waste of consciousness, stop it, unless it feels good. But it doesn't. I've never met a happy shadow worker, ever. So, when you expand beyond your skin will start to feel tight. If you don't expand, your skin won't feel tight. It will just be there, you won't notice it, right? You won't notice your jacket being tight if you don't expand. So similarly, you won't notice what you still hold on to from your old vibratory paradigm if you don't expand beyond that. So what does it mean when you do start to feel contracted and tight? It means you're actually expanding. You're looking at it the wrong way if you judge it negatively. If you feel bad about yourself, what you're saying is, oh, I am contracting. The opposite is happening. The paradigm is still the same size, but you are expanding. That's why you feel the contraction. So as soon as you feel the contraction, deal with it in a positive way. Does that make sense? Approach it instantaneously from a confident place of knowing that you are progressing, you are expanding. And when you do it in that way, you will continue the expansion and you will burst out of your skin. You will show yourself what fits in, what does not fit in, what you want to let go of, and what you want to bring along in a different fashion. Does that make sense? Okay, good. Does that answer your question? Or?
No, that's fantastic, okay, because the flawed premise of a negative emotion has always been, I'm doing something wrong.
Yes.
What am I not getting?
Yes.
I'm inferior. I'm never going to get this. Yes. Bentinho can get it because he's clued up, or I'm not worthy of it.
Or he's never suffered in his life.
Yeah, things like that. So I've the opportunity of finally being here face to face. I just wanted, I know there's a lot of people, a lot of friends watching this right now. So it's like I wanted you to actually say it. You know, negative emotion is actually something working out.
Yes, it means you're doing the right thing. You're doing good. If you're conscious of it, but I assume that if you suffer consciously, then that's a conscious negative feeling. If it's a conscious negative feeling, it means progress. It means you're doing the right thing.
Because you write it down, like you're bumping into a belief, you're going to get an emotion, then
yes,
you're going to have a thought about it. But that all makes sense if you're
yes,
aware of
yes,
what is actually happening.
Yes, and if you would not feel that emotion, you would not discover the belief. Yes. So it's in service. If this is what you're doing, which many people do, and I'm not blaming you at all because it makes sense from where we come from, but it just doesn't work. If this is what you're doing, you're expanding, you're getting excited, you're in your day one new vision of yourself, and day two hits, and there's a little bit of challenge, and there's a little bit of emotionality coming up, and you go, oh, never mind. That is up to you. The emotion doesn't tell you to go, whoop. You choose that the emotion means you should go, whoop. Remember, never take your cues from your circumstances. Emotions are circumstantial. They're not internal, they're circumstantial. See, this is internal. Everything above that is circumstantial. In a sense, even your point of view is circumstantial, but this is so intimate to the I am consciousness that we could call it the inner state. Your point of view, your state of being, your frequency is the only thing that belongs to the inner realm. Everything above that, beliefs, emotions, thoughts, and environment, are circumstances. Don't take your cue from your beliefs, your emotions, your thoughts, and your circumstances. Choose them in accordance with the point of view that feels best. Does that make sense? Okay. So yes, it's a good thing. If you would not feel the emotion, you would most likely not discover the belief. So don't do this. Don't go expand, be excited. Then you hit a threshold and then you go, shit, I'm doing something wrong. Because then you are lowering your frequency and you're basically telling yourself, I'm not ready for the next paradigm. Let me sink back into this one. It feels comfortable. It feels terrible, but it feels comfortable. Let me stay comfortable. I like this couch. So what you want to do is, as soon as the emotion comes up, you're excited because it's progress. So now you're no longer going to be non-excited as soon as an emotion comes up. In fact, you're going to be disappointed if no negative emotion comes up. You're like, fuck, I must be in the same paradigm still. What did I do wrong? Let me excite myself even more. Let me do something even more dangerous, even more cutting edge, even more exciting. And then, oh, there it is, day two challenge. Ha, fun. Okay, this means I've actually progressed. Thank you, now I can feel good about myself because the negative emotion came up. Now I can look at it, see where it comes from. I find the belief is I'm unworthy of this much bliss. Oh shit, is that true? No, of course not. I'm existence itself. There's only one being. I created myself to be in bliss all the time, to express myself as blissfully as I can. So it's just a man-made idea that I picked up along the way from one of my sheep, people, peers, and I just see no more sense in it. It's seems stupid to me to believe that I'm unworthy of this much bliss. It just no longer computes with my level of understanding that I'm inseparable from all that is. And what happens? Boop! You shift, you lock yourself into another point of view that then crystallizes itself into another belief system, and the belief system energetic blueprint paradigm then generates your physical reality. And you can enjoy that for a while until that becomes outgrown. You've learned everything you want to learn from that. You've expressed yourself fully. You've extracted all the benefit there is to be extracted out of that paradigm level reality realm. And now you're ready to move on even more. And then, yes, you're going to have to feel some negative emotions. Now, not all the time. It depends on the degree of the change and how relevant it is. But more often than not, you're going to hit some doubt. You're going to bring to the surface some negative emotion again. That should be a good sign. It is a good sign. Thank you for your question.
Perfecto. Yes. Thank you so much.
Okay, one more question, and then we'll do a little closing meditation.
Hello.
Hey.
It's nice to meet you.
Nice to meet you.
So I'm really glad that you drew this picture because it helps me clarify some questions that I've had and more easily ask them. The first one is a tiny technicality that would just bring me into more full resonance with this picture. Mm. I just want to ask you if it creates any dissonance for you. I just, for me, need to just flip emotions and thoughts.
Okay.
Because I see it as belief as being a very well-installed thought. I see belief as being a very well-installed thought.
Sure.
And then I see thought being generated by a circumstance supported by that belief and emotion immediately following that.
Yes.
So is it okay for you if I switch those?
Yes.
Okay.
Let me clarify then. So for me, that means the same thing. I don't need to switch them because my reasoning is that the environment, the thoughts always reflect the environment. Well, most of the time, it reflects the environment. Emotions reflect the beliefs. So the thoughts correspond all the time. They react to what it sees, right? They react to the present moment physical reality. That's what thoughts usually do, unless you're a really contemplative person all the time. But in general, everyday life, semi-conscious living, thoughts react to the circumstances. If a thought's vibration reverberates deep enough, meaning that it's close enough to trigger a belief, it's a similar vibratory state, then the belief, then the emotion will respond to the belief, right? So But the emotions, this is the other end of thoughts. So thoughts react either to the circumstance or they react to the emotions. They don't really have anything else to react to. So that's why I place them here, because it's squarely placed between environment and emotions, and that's all it can really bounce off of. So then the thoughts go to the emotions and go, oh, well, this is a negative emotion, further reinforcing the thought or the belief, oh, I haven't made it yet, I'm an unworthy portion of creation, I'm not yet enlightened, further separating itself from the enlightenment point of view, therefore feeling even worse, therefore thinking even more bad thoughts, therefore, oh, life is hopeless, and now it's depressed. This whole state is depressed, is in a pinch, in a contraction. So that's why I have thoughts here. But feel free to switch them around.
Okay.
But just as an explanation.
Yeah, I appreciate that.
Okay.
So, would you say it's true that to get greater alignment with that point of view, that it's helpful to often drop down into the experience of the one?
That can be helpful, yeah.
And what I've always thought, and why I love that you made this big, is the one is big,
uh-huh.
And so there are many doorways into it.
Yes.
So really this is a question about, there's so many modalities and teachings out there. So is it really just our choice, the one that, do we need all of those? Because we're such individuals that we need many doorways.
We need as many doorways as there are IMs.
Okay.
In fact, every I am is a doorway into the infinite.
So do you see all these modalities as being useful?
Exactly, yes. Yeah. I don't see them all as being efficient, generally speaking. But if someone really resonates with a particular modality, then there's a purpose behind that. And there is no modality out there that has no audience whatsoever. Yeah. Even if it's only followed by one person, it might be an internal, invisible to the rest of us modality, but then that modality is still appropriate to that being. So whenever I talk to other teachings, or just teachings in general, being sort of redundant or being inefficient, I'm not speaking to their relevance. They can be very relevant to certain people. I'm just like a reviewer of a movie or whatever. I just give my perspective from everything that I've learned, what is in general to the masses, either efficient or not efficient, on large, like, how do you say that, en masse, like, in general. So that does not mean that if something resonates for you that you should not do that. If psychotherapy resonates for you, if shadow work resonates for you, even though I see it as generally inefficient or based on some core misperceptions of how the universe works, that does not mean you should not act on that if it feels relevant. Because if anything that feels resonant or relevant should always be taken above anything that I see, because that's your guidance. If you do the same thing that I'm advising against, which is to externalize your wisdom onto me, then you're doing the same thing that I'm advising against as well, which is to always follow your resonant system above anything else.
So ultimately, you'd want to find the doorway that's most efficient for you.
Oh, absolutely.
Yeah.
Yeah. And that is always the one that's most exciting to you.
Yeah. Okay.
Not the one that seems the rightest, because the most Buddhists believe in it, or the most teachers said it that way. Whatever excites you the most is the best doorway. You got to trust that. If you don't trust that, you're not trusting the universe, and you're pinching off your vessel, your complete openness, the tunnel that goes from all realities to all realities.
Yeah. The point of view.
Yes.
So, let me ask this first.
Yes.
The question from the previous woman. So, this experience of negative emotion is a positive. It's a recognition of our guidance system and a recognition to make, let me say, a course correction with an attention to the belief that's generating that negative emotion or the thought.
Yes.
Would you say that?
Yes.
So, but would we be seeking a shortening of the negative emotion then? You know, a shortening of the amount of time we spend in the negative emotion, an efficiency.
Yes, because we only want to use the negative emotion to become aware of where it comes from. It's a signal, it's a guidance system. It's not meant to linger in or to stay with or to just feel it for the rest of your life. Again, this is my commentary to certain teachings because I see the effects it has on people, which is overall exceptions, excluded, not that positive. It's not that helpful. So utilize the negative emotion as a signal letting you know, oh, hey, wait a second, this is letting me know that a particular vibratory portion of my field does not fit in with the desired field that I want to move into. And that's all that means. Now you go and investigate what that belief is. As soon as you readjust that belief, you no longer ever have to feel that feeling. So why would you feel the feeling and feel the feeling and feel the feeling and maybe even subtly, subconsciously reinforce the feeling by adding thoughts to the feeling, but never actually using it in the way that it's meant to be used, which is trace it back to the belief that causes the feeling to notify you of the belief. Right?
Yeah.
Cool.
And the only last thing that lingers is the point of view. To be able to, is it helpful? Is it inefficient or is it helpful to know that or to understand other point of views, other points of views, out of alignment or not, but that...
Sure, yeah.
Yeah.
I mean, depending on the purpose and whatever.
As
I mean,
there's
infinite points of view out there that you don't understand at all,
yeah.
But those are not relevant for your
for the your only extension. Thing that I'm asking if it's relevant is... To not allow someone else's point of view, which may not be in alignment, and even that says some judgment, right?
Sure.
Right? To not allow that be an excuse to step out of union. Me, right?
Wait, what are you asking?
I'm asking if understanding another's point of view is relevant in that... That understanding helps me not use that point of view that may have created a situation that is negative in some way or uncomfortable in some way or unpleasant in some way, to not allow that be an excuse to step out of union myself. You know, to not allow someone else's action create my excuse.
Sure.
For me to go into separation, for me to come out of that unity consciousness, right?
And yeah, go ahead.
And the only thing that I guess I'm asking you, what is most helpful? Is it understanding that everybody has a different view, or would you say there's something that is more helpful to keep anyone's actions from being an excuse?
Well, the most helpful would be to investigate if something does trigger you, what is the belief that triggers you?
Yeah.
Right? And then secondary to that, you can understand their perception and recognize, third, that it is an equally valid expression of infinity and that it's that it should be appreciated in that way. And when you appreciate another point of view, you're actually free from it. Whereas if you reject another's point of view, you're actually tied to it,
yeah,
right?
Okay.
So understanding it can definitely help you realize, oh, wait a second, this is serving infinity by generating another experience of infinity.
Okay.
But it's simply not my preference. It's not meant for me. Right. So that's awesome. Thank you for expressing infinity in that way so that I don't have to. Okay. Thank God. I can stick to my own resonance.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Hey, Pete. You want to play some guitar with me? Well, by yourself, but... So take a deep breath. Get comfortable. This will just be 5 to 10 minutes. If anyone wants to leave, please do so now. Or forever hold your peace. Take another deep breath and relax your consciousness. And let it drift off to anything of your choice. Like, use this opportunity to practice regaining your free will, to dream big, to reconnect to something that's unique to you. It doesn't have to be anything I've said or explained before. It can be a completely different quality that you've never heard anyone express. Or it can be as cliche as unconditional love. I don't care. Whatever makes you tick, whatever makes you excited, whatever feels the easiest to drop your consciousness into and to become more of and feels actually relevant to who you wish to be as an individuation of everythingness. And just bring your attention to this state of focus, to this vibratory essence, this vibratory image, this vibratory field, this vibratory sensation of being. It's a beautiful way to express infinity, is to merge your consciousness with something that feels absolutely good, holistically good. Let it make you feel even better. Even better. Even better. Think of something that makes you feel even better. And you start to feel it, which means the meditation stage starts to kick in. It starts to become more vivid, more natural. It starts to integrate slowly with your vibratory field. Start to download that alternate reality into your consciousness. Start to shift your point of view, your vibratory state. You are now deliberately choosing your focus of consciousness. You're being a master, not a victim, not a slave. You're being a god, a creator, a chooser, a responsible party of creation, an aware portion of creation. An agent, a free agent of creation. And as you imagine even more of the details that come with that reality, you start to enter a flow of consciousness that becomes so pristine, so clear, so desirable, so important that you forget everything else. And it starts to become your vibratory field. There is no more distinction between here and there. There is now your new here. That is now your new now. That is now your new being. This is merger. This is union. Unification with the vibratory field of your choice. Let yourself drift into this imagination, this imaginative plane of consciousness. Let yourself drift into it. Feel its particulars. Feel it with your being, feel it with your body, feel it with your mind, feel it with your sight, feel it with your consciousness. Feel it with your smell, feel it with your ears. Feel it with the space that you are. Feel the ease of it. It's so effortless because it's so true to who you are. You're simply remembering more of who you already are. That's why it feels so good. You're already complete. Everything you ever desire is already in store for you. You simply amplify it by connecting to it. You accelerate its manifestation by becoming it. Meditate upon it until you become it. And then know that it will manifest in good time. You don't need to worry about the seeds you've already planted. You can simply move on to the next most amazing imaginative state of consciousness. Always letting creation do its job. Don't interfere, don't meddle, don't dominate, don't control the environment. Dominate your frequency. Occupy your space. Occupy yourself. Occupy your state of being with conscious intent, deliberate focus, and imaginative quality. notice how free you are. Your consciousness is never tied to the physical focus. It can go wherever it wants to go and make that more real than anything else. This is samadhi. This is union. To become one with your objective focus. To let your attention be flexible, malleable, and stream-like. Like a constant stream of oil being poured into a pot from yet another pot. Constant, thick continuity of consciousness poured into the vibratory state of your desire, making you feel absolutely amazing, knowing that you are worthy of infinite creation, knowing that you are worthy of infinite desire, knowing that you are worthy of infinite fulfillment, knowing that you are worthy of infinite love, and that all the qualities you seek are already present inside of your consciousness, and you're allowing yourself to drift on them, to serve them freely. Server serves the waves. Ride the waves of your consciousness. Ride the waves of your ecstasy, of your bliss. Serving your way even through your valley experiences with ease and grace and beauty and confidence. Never taking your cue from anything but your own desire. Feel however you want to feel, not however you should feel. See whatever you want to see, not whatever you think you should feel or see. Think whatever you want to think, not what you think you should think. Become a conscious creator, not an unconscious receiver. Become a presenter of creation, a generator. No more victims here. Only consciousness, only intentionality, only imagination. Only what we desire, my friends, only what we desire. What we desire shall be, because it already is. That's why we desire it. We have that power. Be of the vibration that you wish to see the reality of, and then let the reality reflect itself in due time. Know that it will. You don't have to know when or how. Higher self does that for you. How or when are taken care of. Your only duty is to be in the imaginative state that you desire to be in. Be free in that way. Be happy in that way. Be conscious in that way. Be deliberate in that way. Be powerful and precise in that way. Be confident and calm in that way. Be sure of yourself in that way. True mastery is when you exchange the need to control your environment for true confidence in your chosen frequency. You are masters. You just didn't know it. Now you do. Make it conscious. Make it joyful. Make it aligned so that you can be of service to yourself and all the rest of yourself. Joy serves. If you're not happy, you're not helping. Be happy. Be happy first and everything will show itself. Everything will realign itself. Relationships, finances, circumstances, dynamics, the state of the world, the state of the collective, your government. All of these creations, all of these reflections of who you are indeed reflections of who you've chosen yourself to be. Change who you choose yourself to be, and you will change all of these things without changing a single thing. Without lifting a finger, you will change the world. Dominate your vibratory state. That is all you have to do. That is all you wanted to do from the moment you arrived to this earth. You wanted to be conscious. You wanted to be a master of your frequency, and now you're learning to be so. Choose your focus. Develop the adept's focus, the sincere, genuine, desired focus. Be more in that focus, be more in that stream of your choice. Preference is good. Be the preference you wish to see. Paste it onto everything you see. See only what you desire to see. Interpret it only as you desire to interpret it. Make no mistakes in that way. A mistake is when you choose to think something you don't feel good about. Correct it by choosing to think something you do feel good about. Thank yourself for being so conscious, for being so awesome, for regaining mastery and free will. Be in love with yourself, because all that is in love with you already. You're the only one that's not in love with you yet. become more in love with you. Let things come to you with zero effort. Why strive when you can simply be in a state of joy and let things reflect that automatically? Have patience by no longer waiting. Everything you desire is already held for you in the emptiness that you are. Become the emptiness, which is the space of awareness, choosing its desired frequency. And voila, things start popping up effortlessly. Thank you for being here. Thank you for your attention, Sven. Thank you for being true adepts. I appreciate you. I appreciate your commitment, your desire to the greater good by honoring your alignment. And let's have fun. Thank you. If anyone is interested in intuitive guitar lessons, by the way, or knows anyone that's interested in intuitive guitar lessons, meaning not learning notes and all that stuff, but learning to play the guitar intuitively, Pete gives awesome lessons, awesome classes. So just approach him if you want to learn to play like him in your own way, as you learn to play like me in your own way.